and welcome him up here on stage.
Hello, everyone. Hello, world. Mic seems to be functioning all right. That's good. So today we're going to talk about building great things with the WordPress API. And this is, of course, Jason, for all of you who are web nerds, which I'm guessing that maybe all of you are, me at least. So today we're going to talk about the WordPress REST API. We're going to talk a bit, start out with a short background on the API, why you should use it, and then continue on to some things that we built with the API, some tips and tricks and gotchas that we learned along the way. Gonna finish off with how you get started, and what's next, and some other resources that you might want to read up on if you want to do great things with the WordPress API. So first of all, who am I? Could be interesting to know who's standing here rambling. First off, I'm going to say that I am known for rambling and mumbling and talking very fast. So if it becomes very hard to understand me, raise your hand kind of in a warning. I would appreciate that. Thanks. So this is me, obviously, with some more hair and beard. But you will find me on most social networks under the handle cred. Even on Elo, if you're on Elo. I'm a media engineer. Yes, that's actually a real thing. Actually, I have a degree as a media engineer. I'm from the cold northern parts of Sweden, Umeå, if anyone been there. Heja Björklöven. I've been building web since 1996 and WordPress since 06, something like that. I started out my career at Västerbottens-Kuriren, up north. It's a regional newspaper, actually the biggest one in Norrland. So I'm a real media nerd. After Aftonbladet, after Västerbottens-Kuriren, a couple years there, I went on to working as lead developer at Aftonbladet for all of the WordPress platforms. And I have some of my former colleagues here in the audience today. Nice to see you today. And since 2015, in January, I started as a lead developer for our platform at Kit. And Kit is a media startup backed up by Bonnier Media Growth. And those who know your media landscape in Sweden know that I did a change. I'm a switcher from Schibsted to Bonnier. True story. Don't hate me. But that is not what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the WordPress HTTP REST API. And it has actually nothing to do with resting. It's quite the opposite. Well, first of all, API, what's an API? It's an application programming interface. It's kind of self-explanatory. Yes? No? I'm not going to go into the specifics about it, but it's quite a broad definition. But it's a standardized way of the way an application can talk internally and externally. So it's kind of the very dull definition is kind of it expresses the way a component works by its operations, inputs, outputs, and underlying types. And if you summarize that, you could kind of say that it's a programmatic way to interact with an application's data. And most of you have probably some time you have touched an API or maybe used one, the open Facebook Open Graph API, the Twitter API, Google Maps has a great API. Maybe the weather service at yr.no, which has a lot of implementations of the API. So REST, it's a REST API, it's a RESTful API. REST stands for Representational State Transfer. And it's a way of reading and manipulating data via HTTP in this case. Each component or resource in the API is exposed via an endpoint, which is basically a route. And on that route, it mostly evolves around these four verbs. There are actually more, but the most focus is are on those four, the post, the get, the put, and delete verbs. And when you're doing a simple fetch of a web page, you're actually doing a get request. I want to read this data. Post is kind of putting new data into it could be an API or a web form or whatever. Put is kind of updating data, and delete is, of course, deleting data. And this is more commonly known as CRUD operations, where you create by posting, you read by getting, update by putting, and delete by deleting. So CRUD, if you ever see that, now you know what it stands for. Maybe you already did. And it outputs output of this API is in JSON. JSON is JavaScript object notation, and this is a standardized way of structuring data that has kind of become way more popular than XML, that was de facto standard maybe 10 years ago, something like that. If you want to read more, go to json.org, the world's most boring web page. The REST API, WordPress REST API, started back in 2013. This is a really funny conversation between Andrew Nasin, who is one of the core lead developers for WordPress, and Ryan McHugh, who is the lead developer for the REST API project. And Andrew Nasin is kind of questioning whether Ryan McHugh actually knows how much work this will be. And Ryan McHugh says, yeah, I don't agree. It's a lot of work, but I don't agree. We can't get it done before 3.6. 3.6 was Oscar, August 1st, 2013. So the years has gone by. Let's say no more about that. But it started out as a Google Summer of Code when Ryan McHugh, Rachel Baker, and I think that Daniel Bachhuber was also involved in this. So the WordPress API project, it's all about accessing your site's data through an easy-to-use HTTP REST API. This is their own words from the plugin repository. And as I said, it was supposed to be in 3.6, and then they missed their slot for the 4.1 version of WordPress, since they did a total rewrite of the plugin. Meanwhile, it is available as a future as plugin, which means that it is supposed to go into core somewhere in the future near us. The current stable version is 1.2.3 or 0.4, maybe 0.3. And the current beta version of the version 2 of the API is beta 4. One word warning, I will just start off by that right now, because the rest of the presentation might be a bit confusing, and that is due to the version 2 having no backwards compatibility with version 1 at all. It also has no forward compatibility with the next beta. So, a word of warning, things might break when using this API right now. At Kit, where I'm working now, we are still using version 1 in production, since version 2 is it's kind of ready for production if you read between the lines, and if you are in the chat room for the core API on Slack, they kind of want you to use the 2.0 version, because it's a lot better. We began migrating, and it is very easy to go from version 1 to version 2. So, as I said, you can perform CRUD operations on the standard WordPress resources like post, post meta, post revisions, pages, media, comments, taxonomies, terms, and users. So it basically means that you can fetch all of this data, you can update the data, you can delete data, you can create new data, which is basically exactly what WordPress does with PHP today. And that's good, of course. But maybe you're asking, why bother? Well, I'll tell you why. First of all, we talked a little bit earlier today about decoupling of concerns in different ways when it comes to scaling WordPress, for example, in Amazon. And this is just one more way to do this. At Kit, we're using WordPress just as a backend. We're actually not using any PHP at all for our main site. I will show that later. And the API kind of enables this for us. Without API, this wouldn't be possible. So if you think of WordPress as just a backend, you would have the admin system, which is really good for editors. You would have plugins, tons of plugins that will help you get a lot of features and nifty things that you might want. So you have a really sturdy CMS. And then you can build your front end with basically anything. It might be JavaScript, if you're into JavaScript, which a lot of people are. I'm actually started out as a front end developer, so I'm also quite in love with JavaScript, especially since the Renaissance. So you might build your front end with Ember, Angular, or Backbone, or Knockout.js, or Vanilla.js, if you want to. Go to vanillajs.com. And you will find out more. No, just kidding. Of course, but you can use whatever front and JavaScript front-end framework you really like. It might be that you like Node, and you want to build things with React, which is a really nifty, I wouldn't say framework, but library for building a very slick and fast UI. This is most of you have used Facebook, yes, and Facebook. This is the way they're drawing their UI. To us users. And the most important thing is that you don't need to know any PHP at all if you use the API as your data source. Let's say that you only like HTML, JS, and CSS, which a lot of front-end developers do, and you're really, really skilled at this, and you don't want to learn any PHP at all. It can be understandable. Kind of depending on what you have, your views on PHP. But it really opens up WordPress for, let's say, a new generation of developers, front-end developers and theme developers that want to build great things with WordPress, but they don't want to learn any PHP at all. So, as I said, they have now they have the possibility to access all the data, update all the data. And things you could do as well, of course, you can use it as a backend for apps, any kind of app, be it iOS, Android, Windows Phone. Anyone? No, no Windows Phone there. It would be a natural way of using WordPress as your backend for creating data and for keeping your application up to date. And you can, of course, use it for building OS X applications, Windows applications, Chrome extensions, whatever your cup of tea might be. And this is some short examples just of, this is from WordPress.com. This is their new admin, reinvented. And they're actually using the WordPress.com API, which is not the same, but it kind of gives you the idea what you might be able to do. This is powered, as I said, by the WordPress.com JSON API, which you can use today as well if you use Jetpack, I think. I haven't actually tried that feature myself, but yeah, someone's nodding. That's good. So most probably I'm right about that. You can also build this. This is another example of a very custom WordPress admin interface. This is Happy Tables. Some sort of service for creating restaurant websites. And this is the place where Ryan McHugh, the lead developer for this project, is working. So, of course, it's not natural that they would use it. And this is a conversation management system called Jetty that also built a custom admin interface on top of WordPress using the API. So, I'm going to give you. Going to talk a little bit about what we built and things that we learned along the way. So first of all, I'm going to give you a short demo of the site, and I really, really hope that the Wi-Fi is working again. Can anyone verify that? All right. So I'm going to try out the Wi-Fi because when I tested this, 10 minutes before beginning my presentation, the Wi-Fi was down. And it will be a really dull presentation. So let's hope. I'm going to go out of full screen mode. Let's do that. And I'm going to go to mirroring instead. All right, so now I'm at C is the correct network, yes? Yeah. All right, so let's see if kit.se. Yay, fantastic. So this is kit.se. It's a page where we write about our the questions of our time or topics for of our time. So it's kind of a quality journalism for the modern person. So this is our start page, and we actually have no navigation. I'm not going to talk more about that, but it was quite an upset when we launched back in April. This is what we call our discovery block. It's what we're writing about right now. This is the only navigation on the site. So let's open up a post. We can take, I'm actually going to go do this. I have some posts prepared. And I don't have the post prepared that I was supposed to show you. That's good. Oh, now I know why. Sorry about that. This is a post from the other day. As you can see, this is kind of the standard content that we'd see from any WordPress post. We have a post header with a large image background. We have the title, we have an excerpt. We have some metadata, multiple offers, and this is via the CoAuthor Plus plugin. We have the content. So it's a quite standard way of showing a post or an article. The thing is that we changed the output quite a bit to better suit our needs, and this is entire web page is built with Angular.js. So we only have one page load from one static page, index.html, and that page is actually served from a S3 bucket via Cloudflare. So no PHP at all involving booting up our page. If I go to the bottom, we will see the discovery block again, and I will launch another page. Here we have another post format. The post header is kind of a smaller image, medium-like if you want to, medium.com that is, with two authors, one who has done a photo illustration and one has written the text. So nothing strange here. Basically a post and our discovery block. These are two different HTTP requests to the API. One is fetching post data, the other one is a custom endpoint for our discovery block. And I will show a little bit more about that later. I will also show you some extra data. Let's do this, yeah. We also have some extra information, things like we have a story concept where a story is a custom taxonomy where you could connect different posts to each other. And I'm just going to show this because later on, I'm going to show you how to extend the API, because you might want to do that. You probably want to do that if you're building a more advanced page, website. And this is just a storyline with five posts connected to each other with advanced custom fields. So go to kit.se and with your mobile phone if you want to, or later after the presentation. Stay on and listen for now. So I'm going to go, well, we can actually continue here. So the basics first, if you want to fetch data from the API, in version 1, you would just enable the API, the plugin. You would have, of course, pretty permalinks, but I'm guessing most of you already have pretty permalinks. If you want to access core data, you would go to /wp-json. In the version 2, they introduced namespacing, so the WordPress core data is available under the namespace WordPress/ wp/version 2. And namespacing is actually a really good thing that you I think that you're actually forced to use that if you are using custom endpoints in the version 2. So some example requests. First of all, I'm going to show you how to kind of discover an API, finding out all of the endpoints. And I'm actually going to go to wired.com since we have disabled that endpoint on kit.se. That wouldn't be a very good demo. I hope you can see this. I was warned to use a white background in my presentation. I don't know why. Have you seen, have anyone had problems with the white backgrounds so far? No. Well, this is good as well. If you go to wired.com/wp-json, you would see all of the routes available, and you would see what RESTful verbs they accept, so what endpoints are available at each route. And here you can see that on Wired, we can go to slash, we can go to slash posts, we can go to a specific post, post/ID. And it, you can just scroll through and kind of discover what is available, what data can I actually find from this API. So if I want to find post data, let's do that on Wired as well. This is a post about Facebook launching M the other day. The bold answer to Siri and Cortana. And as you can see in my address field, I'm just going to wired.com/posts/the ID. Quite simple. Under this endpoint, I will find the typical data that I would expect to find from a post. Things like information about the author, the content itself. Terms connected to this one, images, featured images, and things like that. I won't linger on this one because time is of the essence here. I only have 40 minutes. At kit.se, oh, where's my... this is our first post, or it's actually called Hello World, but in Swedish. You can see that we have actually modified the output of the content. In our case, we have, for the content, we don't just have the content from the database. Instead, we have the featured image as one resource. We have the split the content into different blocks where each block is paragraphs, images, block quotes, etc. And this is just for making it easier for our Angular app to read the data and structure it in a very good way. And I will show you later a bit about how you would go about doing this, because you might want to do that, maybe not. You want to, kind of depends on what front end or app you're building. If you want to run the loop, you could do that as well. If you take a look here, I'm going to go to the slash posts. I can add some filter variables where I can just say, I want 3 posts per page, and it should only be the author with ID 77, which is Martin Schury, our news head of news at Kit. And you can use any variable that is publicly available, which you could attach to any WordPress site just by adding it to the URL field. So let's say that I want to read only Viola's posts. I would just change the author. Each of these parameters available are documented at wp-api.org. Sorry. I talked a little bit about our custom endpoint. I'm just going to... This is our custom endpoint, and as you can see, this is registered at slash discovery. Yeah, you can actually see that. It's good. Maybe I should have looked up earlier. And the discovery endpoint is kind of also only outputting posts, but we are stripping away some tags, we're removing some categories, and we're doing a kind of another sort order of the post, things like that, to have it more personalized for the users. So far, it's pretty basic, but it's going to be more advanced further on. And since we don't want to add all of these filters, parameters to our request, we built a custom endpoint instead, because we're also removing some data like the content. It's not needed for every payload. So then it makes a lot of sense to kind of have a custom endpoint with just the data that we want. Right, let's go back. And if you want to discover the API, this is from Wired again. You can go to, let's say that you want to find out all of which categories are available. You would just go to /taxonomies/category/terms, and we would see all of the categories available, like accessories, who happens to have 157 posts in it on wired.com. So these are the basics kind of accessing data. And now, of course, as I said, I'm just doing GET requests. So I'm just accessing the GET endpoint of the route. Right. A word of warning. There will be some code now. So if you don't like code, I guess don't leave the room, but maybe you can just tag along for the ride, I guess. If you want to modify post data, this is version 1. I'm going to give you an example of version 2 as well. You should use the filter JSON prepare post, where you would have kind of access to the entire post object that is about to be rendered for the user, and you could kind of do whatever you want with it. In this case, I'm changing the post title to Hello World for all posts. That doesn't make any sense at all. But maybe you could add some better data, like maybe you want to add related posts from an ACF controller, or maybe you want to add another featured image. Maybe you have four featured images or things like that. Here is where you would add that data to the post before it gets outputted to the browser or whatever client is accessing it. In version 2, they changed this to be actually much better. You would hook on to the REST API init action, and you would use the register API field. And you would hook into whatever resource you want to target. In this case, I'm targeting a post, but it could be also a post, a page, a user, or a attachment, or whatever you want to do. You add a field. Like in this case, I'm going to add a field called random info. And for all of the GET requests, I'm going to just add some random info. I don't have a callback at all for a put request, but I could have that. Let's say that someone wants to update a post via the API. What should I do with my field called random info? Then I can register a function for that. So this is the awesome function for outputting random data. And it just adds some random data in a MD5 hash. So it looks like this. Now I'm actually running the API on my local installation, which is a Vagrant box, which you should stay and listen on to for the next presentation, because it might just be the best thing since sliced bread. And in this case, I have a post, all the posts. I'm accessing the /wp/version2/posts, and hopefully I have some random info data here. So that's how easy it is to add custom data to the post's endpoint. It could be a user, it could be an attachment as well. And if you look at our live site, like here on Hello World, it could actually be things like we add some read data, like how many words are in this text, what's the expected read time, do we have any embeds, do we have any images, and this is just information for our Angular app in this case, kind of how should it handle long text or short text and things like that. Carrying on, if you want to modify post data, the previous example we're just adding, if you want to modify post data, let's say that every title should be Hello World, like in my example earlier, or that you want to remove the information on whether a post is sticky or not, then you would use the REST prepare post, which is quite much like the JSON prepare post in the version 1, but in version 2 it's called REST prepare post instead. A word of warning from the team behind the API, don't remove data, because it might break third-party applications trying to talk to your site via the API. But we have an internal app, so we're removing a lot of data and restructuring a lot of data. We are cowboys, yes. And you can modify all data from all the resources that are available. This is just from a search in PHP Storm. You can see that there are filters for attachment comments, meta values, all post types, pages, of course, taxonomy terms, users. So you could kind of change and restructure all the information that is going out from the API. Yeah, carrying on. If you want to modify offer data, that is quite a common scenario. Let's say that you want to add Twitter information, Facebook information, things like that. In version one, we would use the JSON prepare user, and just same as the post, you would have access to the user object, and you can just change whatever data and add whatever data you want to. In version two, as I mentioned, it's exactly the same as earlier, but I'm attaching it to the user instead. Now I'm adding some user extra info, and I'm just adding the Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram information that we added to the admin. So it would look like this, accessing it in version two. Here we see that on Viola, that is on their version two users 30, I would get information about Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And I don't think that this is her Facebook. No, that's not her. Oh, don't click on that link if you view this afterwards. This is our live API right now, and here you can actually see that we're adding Twitter information. This is for Christian Geyer. This is his Twitter account, and we're using this information in the offer presentation for our posts, so you can access their Twitter directly by just clicking it. If you want to remove endpoints, also again, a word of warning from the API team, don't remove endpoints. But if you want to remove endpoints, if you don't want to expose everything that you have registered, like wired, you could use the JSON endpoints filter, and it's actually exactly the same in version 2, so I'm going to show that instead. It's called REST endpoints instead. You would just kind of hook into that filter with access to all the endpoints in one giant array, and you could just choose whatever endpoints you would like to disable. So at Kit, we have disabled, for example, the comments endpoint. We're not using comments. Also, media and categories and things like that. You have to be logged in to view those endpoints. Don't ignore those ID things. It's the highlighting plugin that I use that kind of don't like this. So ignore these ones. If you're trying this example, skip the ID ending closing tags in the at the bottom. So adding endpoints. As I showed you, we have this discovery block, and this is how we hook into adding the discovery route and endpoint. You would hook on to the in version one. You would hook on to the JSON endpoints filter again, and you would just add the slash discovery endpoint. You would say what function do I want to run when accessing this endpoint, and what RESTful verbs should I take into consideration. In this case, I'm using a constant from this WordPress JSON server class that is readable, which is only I could easily just write a string get. Instead, I'm accepting get request to this endpoint. In version 2, it's actually a lot better. You would hook on to the REST API action again, and you would use the REST route instead, which makes a lot more sense. I talked a little bit about the namespacing earlier, and you should use that. You're actually forced to use namespacing, which is really good. In this case, I'm using the Kit version 2 namespace. I'm adding the route to my where I'm supposed to access this. And in this case, I'm using just slash discovery, but it could also be a regular expression that where you could take maybe a slug or an ID or something like that if you want to maybe access a specific page, a specific user, or a custom post type that you have registered. And in this case, I'm just accepting get request, and I want to run the Kit get discovery function when this is accessed. And that function, in this case, just for demo purposes, I've done a kind of get one post that is random, and just output it as a random post just for demo purposes, which is kind of what the discover block is almost. And two good things that they improved also in the version 2 is that if you want to throw an error in the API, kind of no post found or this route is not valid because you don't have a valid input or things like that, you would throw a WordPress error saying that there is no post available and just send whatever status that you find suitable. In this case, if there is no post, send a 404, which is much better for any REST client that wants to talk to your API. Same goes for any successful response, where you would say that send a WordPress REST response and with the proper status code as well. So this fantastic function, it looks something like this. As you can see, I'm running this on my local machine at version 2 of the API at the discovery endpoint, and I would get some random info and a random post. So when I refresh this page, I'm going to get another post. Yep, this is something about the YouGov. And this is a recipe for a banana and peanut milkshake. One thing to another. So it's quite easy to register on your own endpoint, and you should really do this if you have very specific data that you want to access. It might be that you want to combine two different posts or combine extra user info with some crazy media attachment and a taxonomy. Don't do a super complex query for the slash post endpoint. Instead, just write your own endpoint instead. It's quite simple and much better performance. And doing this, you should not do as in my example. Actually, you should extend the, they have a REST controller class that you should extend instead. And examples of that are available in their documentation. And this is just for showing the kind of, that you could use regular expressions instead. Which is very powerful. And in this case, I'm registering an endpoint for the version 2 of Kit, and I'm saying I want a page with a slug, and the slug should be alphanumeric, still alphabetical, and underscores and dashes. I'm also running for this parameter, I can run sanitization for the input, I can run validation, I can run whether it's required, default values, and I can also add permissions, kind of you need to be able to edit options to access this endpoint, whatever. So in this case, it's just about getting a post, and that was what you saw at the starting of this presentation. This is getting a page called Hello WC Enkepig. It's a real tongue twister. It's not a hard Swedish word, it's a real tongue twister. So, that was a little bit about, I'm going to go like that. I'm going to go back into presentation mode, actually. If I can find that, that's good. So. That was a short demo, kind of what we built and things that we learned, and kind of showing how easy it is to both access the data that is already there, but you can also extend and change and modify it to suit every need that you might have. So authentication then. If I want to create a new post, of course, I would need to be authenticated somehow. And this is covered, of course, by the API. Read the documentation. This is quite good, where you can read up kind of what you how you do this and of course why is that's not a hard question, but how at least. The most simple way is using the cookies, the logged in cookie. It's called WordPress _ logged in, something like that. And this is what you would use if you are building a theme, because you would have that cookie available already. So you just kind of send that with your request to the API. Just remember to add a nonce as well, called WP_REST, because it needs to verify to protect you from cross-site forgery. I actually didn't read that line when trying out the API first time. It was a bad idea. I would have saved 1 hour of my life if I would have done that. You could use BasicAuth as well for development and staging, and BasicAuth is quite easy to get up and running. You send your username and password with every request to the API as an authorization header. Of course, the negative thing with this is that you actually send your password and your username with every request, so you should never use this in production. Never, ever, ever. But But you can try it out. You can try it. It's quite easy if you use Postman or something like that, which is a Chrome extension for trying out RESTful APIs. One word warning there as well is don't send your cookie if you're doing a basic auth request, because then it will, the cookie will take precedence over the basic auth. But since you're not sending any nonce, your authorization will just fail and you will think that it is the basic auth failing, but it's actually not, it's the cookie. And that took, I think, that one workday of my life before I realized that. So that was a good gotcha. For production, you should use the OAuth1a implementation. That is much, much more safer. OAuth1, has anyone used it? One person, two person. I think it's really complex. I can't really wrap my head around what's going on in the OAuth1 process. OAuth2 is much, much better, since it forces you to use SSL connection, kind of eliminating the problem of having your connection secure. It's kind of that's SSL's problem instead. But they have a plugin for this, which you can download. It's not actually quite ready for production. You have to use the WordPress CLI tool to create your applications and things like that. So it's not working kind of out of the box, but it works. I have got it up and running. And this will be, by the time that the API is integrated into core, the OAuth1 integration will be there as well, making it easy for your application to talk to WordPress in a safe manner. And there are some other examples, of course. It's not only us at kit.se that have used API. You can look at this New York Times presentation from WordCamp, that I can't remember which one, but they built a live event engine using the API. Bookoop, they do a lot of great Node.js things, like Grunt, for example, if anyone have used Grunt. This is a talk from a WordCamp where they used WordPress as just a backend for their Node.js application. WordPress backup plugin, I guess you can call it, are using an integrated version of the API. Custom contact forms are also using it. Also the WordPress live search, which is from the guy that did the Aesop story engine, if anyone used that. He's built a live search plugin that gives you really nice live feedback on your search. That was overusing the word live. AppPress and the Reactor Core, I think their tagline is kind of transform your WordPress to an app, or things like that. They're also relying on the API to do a request to the WordPress as a backend. The Sunday Times in United Kingdom, they have built a plugin for exposing the advanced custom fields from a post in the API. So you can take a look at that. And of course, the Wired magazine are using the API for something. I don't know why, but they actually have the API there running, as you can see in my examples. So let's move on to the next part, which is kind of, now you're wondering, how do I get started? How do I build my awesome, how do I use this awesome API? And you could go to the plugin repo at wordpress.org, and you would find both version 1 at the JSON REST API, or version 2 that is just called the REST API, because it made no sense, of course, calling it the JSON REST API, because JSON is what we're outputting right now. But in 5 years, it might be... Oh, I can't come up with an acronym that sounds strange enough, but you get it. It might be called Bernie instead of JSON, something like that. And if you have an hawk's eye, you could actually see that I am running both version 1 and version 2 in my local environment. So the version 2 was actually registered at wp-rest instead of wp-json. And it's quite easy to have them running side by side if you want to try out the difference between version 1 and version 2. Go to GitHub if you want to see what they're up to. They're doing their main development at GitHub. Also, if you want to contribute, it's quite good, or if you have any issues that you want to report. Documentation you will find at wp-api.org and version 2 of it as well. So here's some quick words on what's next. This will be also some speculation by me. It's going to be integrated into core sooner or later. Rumor says that it is going to be this year, and it would be really good if it was the most this year. And I think that going into the core of WordPress, we will see a lot more support from plugins that will be adapted for the API. And this is did a search for REST API on WordPress.org plugin repo. And this here you can see already that we have some support from some plugins, like the advanced custom fields for REST API. We have the Genesis REST API, Search VPI have some integration and such. And I think that it wouldn't be crazy. Now I'm just speculating, but we will probably see something like this, let's say in 1 year, that plugins at plugins WordPress.org in that repo will kind of let you know whether or not they have support for the API. Will they output their data in post? Will they output their data in taxonomies or whatever the plugin is doing? Let's say that it's a plugin for adding categories to media. Would that this plugin output that in the API? It would make sense to do that. So maybe it won't look like this. Maybe all of the plugins will have support for the API. But I think it would be reasonable to have this, so that we know, so that with that we don't have to find these third-party plugins on GitHub or whatever. Some examples, kind of what's to come. Pods is kind of a custom post type thing. I haven't used it myself, but I think it's quite used. They built integration to the API, exposing their fields. Oh, it says it doesn't work yet, but so as far as I know, it should be working. BuddyPress, I think there was a session about BuddyPress earlier here. Yeah, they have an integration with the REST API, exposing whatever data you might need. We will also see, I think, more and more. I talked earlier about kind of the new generation of theme creators for WordPress that knows no PHP at all, but are building things only with JavaScript and HTML and CSS. And this is one example of that. It's called Picard, and it's by a guy named Jack Lennox. He works for Automattic. He's a design engineer, I think. And he built a theme that is running on React, the Node.js Node.js library. So it's no PHP at all. I think that actually all the PHP files here are actually just booting up the JavaScripts instead. And we'll see more advanced themes kind of not relying on WordPress as a PHP platform. And of course, applications for mobile phones, for Windows computers, Apple computers, Chrome extensions, and whatnot. So if you really want to do a lot of reading about the API, here are some great links. Now we're going to visit them one by one. No, we're not going to do that. But if you want to find out more, real good reading. Kind of click through. And that was all. Thanks for listening.
We are running a bit short on time. The next session will begin in 24 seconds. So if you're heading downstairs, make sure to do it quick. We can do a few questions. So if you're not heading down, feel free to ask questions.
I forgot to mention that I'm also very good at not keeping times on presentation. Apparently not today either. If we have a little time for questions, if we don't have enough time for questions, just contact me on whatever social network that you might be on, or mail me at cl@kit.se.